Hello everyone, I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for joining me. We're talking about mathematics and music, and today's pretty interesting because I want to first of all have a careful look at the distinction between what I call tones and notes. We're going to talk about a terminology, notation to describe the notes on the piano, so not just the ones in a particular octave, but more generally. This will lead us to a discussion of the duodecimal number system just a little bit. But then we're going to shift gears. Having understood that situation, it's quite sort of elementary and easy, and you know, we just sort of follow our nose. But after we've done that, we're going to have a realization, sort of like a Eureka moment, okay? Where we're going to realize that this understanding that we've been developing here in this musical context has a huge implication for the way we structure arithmetic out in the real world. High school, in primary school, university level, the research level. The way we think about our number line, we can revolutionize that. We can find a completely different and new approach, I think it's new, to the way we describe numbers. So lots of interesting things happening today. So I've talked a lot about the importance of the 12-tone chromatic scale and therefore labeling the tones that we commonly use in the Western system between a note and an octave above it with the 12 numbers from 0 to 11. So if we start, say, on this middle C, which is a familiar place to start if you're a piano player, then we have notes 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and then back here to the C, which either is 12 or 0. And we've seen that this corresponds to the geometry of a clock, and it's really sort of mod 12 arithmetic. Now, I want to make a distinction, a very important distinction, which I've skirted around in these lectures so far, but I haven't actually put my finger on it. So it's time for us to distinguish between what we're going to call tones and notes. So this note here, this is a C, has the same name as that one. It's also a C. C. C, C, C. There are lots of C's, okay? And in our system, let's say we're assigning C the numerical value 0, so we're thinking of that as tone 0, then the tone of this is 0, and the tone of this is 0. So as far as these numbers between 0 and 11 are concerned, these are indistinguishable. So let's agree to think about these numbers from 0 to 11, representing the various positions on a clock, as the possible tones, okay? So let's agree that this sound and this sound have the same tone, okay? They are both represented by a D on the piano, or in our system, if we're starting at C, with the note 2. That's also a 2, that's also a 2, that's also a 2, that's also a 2, etc. So we'll say that these notes have the same tone. Physically, in terms of the frequencies of the notes generated by the strings, there's a relation of a factor of 2 between these, right? So the frequency here is twice that of the other. So that's another way of saying what this tonal relationship is. So we have 12 tones that actually correspond to these notes sort of up to a factor of 2, all right? So as far as tones go, this is the same tone as this tone. Same tone as this tone, same tone as this tone. So there are, in fact, 12 tones on the piano from 0 to 11. Okay, that's tones. Now let's talk about notes, okay? We also want to, of course, be able to distinguish between this note and this note occasionally, right? They may have the same tone, but they're actually different notes. The frequencies are actually different. So let's actually use the word note for that concept. So a note is a frequency. That and that are then different notes. They have the same tone, but they are actually different notes. Okay? That's, of course, important because if we're playing music, well, we're going all over the place, you know? So we've got to be able to distinguish between, you know, notes up here and notes down there, even if they're the same tone. So this leads us naturally to a very obvious question. What's a systematic way of describing the various notes on a piano? This is an absolutely fundamental question in music. And as far as I can tell, it's not really been well addressed. So if you're a musician, okay, so this is usually called C, okay? It's called middle C. What about this C? It's also a C, but what C is that? Well, maybe it's like, the next C up, or high C. Or maybe this is high C. Maybe this is, I don't know what the C is. High C, really high C, super high C. Is that the best we can do? I don't think we have really a consistent way of describing these notes. Like this note right here. What is that note exactly? What is note, this one here, what is that note exactly? Yes, it's a C sharp or a D flat, but how do you distinguish it between the other C sharps or D flats? So we're going to address that now. So the obvious way to approach this problem, I think, is to recognize that we already have a prior system for describing the notes, say, between this C and this C. That's the one we've already discussed. The various tones describe the distinction between these notes from here to here. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Okay. So what we really want to do is we want to sort of take this system, which is already in place for this octave, and somehow sort of translate it here, and then here, and then here, and then also down here, and here, and here, etc. So what's the sort of obvious way of doing that? Well, I think the obvious way of doing that is to use a sort of a same kind of approach that we use in decimal arithmetic, to recognize that we have, you know, a bigger unit here. We have a small unit going from here to here, that's sort of one, but going from here to here is another kind of unit. So we'll introduce another number to tell us which one of these bigger ranges we're in. You know, sort of like the distinction between inches and feet, or between centimeters and meters, okay? So let's agree that, since it's middle C, let's agree that this first octave here is the zeroth octave, because we kind of like to start our counting with zero. That's the same thing that we did with the tones, right? Zero, one, two. So this will be octave zero. This then will be octave one. This will be octave two. This will be octave three. So if we want to specify one of the notes in this direction, we can specify what octave it's in by just the number, zero, one, two, three. And then a secondary number that tells us which tone in that octave we're talking about. So for example, this note here is in octave zero and it's tone seven. So we might write it as 0.7. This one here, it's the same tone but a different octave, this would be 1.7. This would be 2.7, 3.7. This one here, that's tone number 10 in our system. So as a note, to place it on the whole piano, we would say it's 0.10 in the zeroth octave, the 10th note. This note here, that's a note 6, or in the tone sense, but it's in octave 1, so that's 1.6. Now we don't have to use a decimal point, we could use a slash or a hyphen or a colon or something, just something to distinguish between these various scales at which we're looking at things. Okay, maybe the decimal point is a little bit confusing, so let's use a slash, okay? So just temporarily, okay? So this note here, okay, which is ordinarily, I guess, an 8 in the tone system. This is in the first octave, and it's the 8th tone, so it'll be 1/8. Okay, that's the name of that note. What about down here? If this is octave 0, that's octave 1, and that's octave 2, what should this octave be? Well, there's only one answer to that question. It's going to be the octave minus 1. This is the octave minus 2. This is the octave minus 3. Okay, so what is this note here? The G. The note 7 up here, tone 7. Okay, down here, it's still tone 7 in this octave here. But now it's in the octave called minus 1. So the name of this note would be -1/7. This one would be -2/7. How about this one here? Just a little bit less than the one less one step down from the middle C. Well, this is going to be in this octave, so it's in the minus one octave, and it's note number 11. So it's -1/11. Okay, so there, we've accomplished what we wanted to do. We've now given a systematic procedure for describing the exact note value of any note on the piano, or in fact, in principle, going further down or further up. An octave number, which is going to be an integer, like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, or perhaps -1, -2, -3, -4, -5, etc. And then a slash, perhaps, and then one of our tone notes, a number between 0 and 12. Now, if we think about this, this is actually pretty close to a sort of a numerical system, like a base 12 system. So throughout history, people have suggested strongly that we should actually move from a decimal system to a 12 base system, or a duodecimal system. Sometimes actually also called a dozenal system. There's actually societies in various countries around the world that promote this idea. And there's a lot of things to be said for it, because the number 12 is quite attractive as a base because it's so highly divisible. It has factors 2, 3, 4, 6. There's a lot of factors. And that actually makes arithmetic in a base 12 system actually noticeably simpler than in a decimal system. So one can actually demonstrate that, I think, pretty convincingly. And of course, if you want to go one step or a big step further, then you can include the 5. So 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Then you get the base 60 system, which is the one which is arguably the oldest system in the world, the Sumerian, Akkadian, Babylonian sexagesimal system. And the advantages of the duodecimal system are repeated, but even amplified, by the sexagesimal system, which is pretty, pretty convincingly probably the most effective, powerful the numerical systems. Like, this is the best base probably to use if you really want to do extensive calculations. That's a highly debatable thing, but I think a strong case could be made. Okay, but in any case, so a base 12. How does a base 12 system work? So you have decimals, but instead of having digits from 0 to 9, 10, you need two more digits. So we've been talking about 0 up to 9. 9 and then 10, 11, but in a base 12 system, you'd have to use two other symbols, typically A and B. Okay, so a base 12 system is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, A, B, and then back to 0. That way you have single digits for all of the notes. So, okay, we could morph what we've just talked about on the piano, okay, to make it fit more smoothly to a duodecimal system by replacing all the 10s and 11s just with A's and B's. Okay, then all of our notes that we've been talking about are represented by an integer and then a slash and then one of our 12 duodecimal digits, 0 up to 9, A and B. So that's pretty interesting. And now, having that firmly in our minds, we can make a very big step. We can say, but wait a minute. Doesn't this say something really profound about the arithmetic? Because notably, while this is very parallel to the decimal arithmetic that we use to describe a line, it is crucially different. What's the difference? Let me remind you that when you're working on a number line, okay, you have 0, you have 1, you have 2, you have -1, you have -2, fine. And between 0 and 1, if you're working in a decimal system, you have these gradations, 0 and then 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, up to 0.9, and then 1, and then 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, up to 1.9, and then 2, etc. And that's repeated as you go up. But, and it's a very, very big but, if you take the interval from 0 to 1 and then sort of translated from -1 to 0, what does the notation become? It becomes completely different. Why? Because we don't just translate. We don't translate the existing scale from 0 to 1. That's what we've been doing to go up to the right. We take this existing scale from between 0 and 1 and we translate it. But when we go to -1, 0, we don't translate it. What we do is we reflect it. It's a different transformation right at the zero. We cut it there and we reflect. So that as we're reading down the scale, we're reading from right to left. Zero and then minus 0.1, minus 0.2, minus 0.3, down to minus 0.9, and then minus 1. And then minus 1.1, minus 1.2. That's different from what we were just been talking about on the piano. Let that sink into you. I hope you know, it's like a eureka moment to realize that. What we are doing with the traditional number line, the way we currently have it, it's prejudicing this reflection, the reflection, the symmetry around zero above the translational symmetry. We're saying the reflection around zero, the distinction between right and left from this particular point is more important to us than the otherwise obvious symmetry of translation invariance. When we were talking about the piano, we did not have that bias. We could see that this octave and this octave and this octave and this octave and this octave, they're all the same and they should be sort of treated the same. We should read each one of them from left to right. So, this gives us the possibility of seriously revamping arithmetic by adopting a musical approach. Okay, so even in the decimal situation, you have 0 to 1, labeled 0, 0.1, 0.2, 0.3. And what are these numbers? 0 point, or you could 0 slash, 1, 2, 3, up to 9. Then up at 1, you go 1 slash 1, 1 slash 2, 1 slash 3, up to 1 slash 9. Now if we translate down to the interval between minus 1 and 0, we can describe those numbers by the expressions minus 1, slash 1, slash 2, slash 3, slash 4, up to slash 9, moving from left to right. So that the whole thing is translation invariant. People, why are we not doing this? Can you give a good reason? Other than historical reasons. But I mean, logically, what's really going on here? Should the musical approach prevail? I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.